So this was a summary of yesterday's class, and now where did my cursor go? So before moving into the repressible operon, this is a comparative picture of a inducible operon, negative inducible operon, and a negative repressible operon. We have just yesterday studied the negative inducible operon. So you can see the negative inducible operon, to repeat, this is the repressor or the regulator gene producing the regulator protein. See, lac is not present in the system. So there is no lactose in the system. Let us compare. So when there is no lactose in the system, the active repressor or the regulator protein is produced. And this regulator protein, as we know in lactose, can go and bind with the operator. Since the regulator protein can bind with the operator, even though RNA polymerase can sit at the promoter region, but because the regulator and the operator are bound to each other, as a result of which the RNA polymerase cannot proceed past the operator and there is no transcription. So in absence of lactose, you don't get any product. The moment lactose is given, the regulator gene is producing the repressor protein or the regulator protein. And you can see, we know lactose is converted to allolactose, and allolactose binds to the repressor protein. The moment the allolactose binds to the repressor protein is inactivated and it cannot bind to the operator anymore. So polymerase can come and polymerase sits on the promoter and with ease can transcribe the downstream ZYNA gene. So in absence of lactose, the operon is switched off. In presence of lactose, the operon is switched on. Hence, it is a negative inducible operon. Now coming to a very contrasting picture, that is the negative repressible operon. Here also, if you look into similarity, let's look at the similarity. There is a regulator gene and there is an operon, which is a polycystronic, which produces a polycystronic mRNA. Very similar to lac, with a common promoter element and operator element. And there are five genes here. We'll be studying the tryptophan operon. So there are five genes in its biosynthesis. So we have a regulator gene just like lac. We have an operon just like lac. So this is the, let us, for example, we'll be studying tryptophan operon. So let us consider this to be the tryptophan operon. Now, in absence of the product, no product, there is no tryptophan in the system, the repressor protein is produced, as you can see. And this repressor is the inactive repressor. This is the first difference. When I compare this one with this one, you see, in case of when there is no lactose present, we had an active repressor that went and bound, got itself attached to the DNA sequences of the operator region. But in case of tryptophan, we have an inactive repressor which cannot bind to the operator region. So in absence of tryptophan, you can see the transcription of genes are occurring. Since no repressor can bind to the operator region, so what will happen? RNA polymerase will come and sit in the promoter region. And since it will not get any block from any repressor protein, it will synthesize the five genes. So this is the first difference. In case of lac operon, that was a negative inducible operon, we studied that the repressor protein in absence of lactose gets attached to the operator. So the repressor protein was in active form. In negative inducible operon, what we saw is that the repressor is in inactive form, and being in inactive form, it cannot bind to the operator. And so the operon is switched on. Now, when the product is given, in case of negative repressible operon, what happens? The product binds with the repressor. You see, the product binds with the repressor, and now the repressor is converted to an active repressor. This active repressor now binds to the operator. The moment the repressor is bound to the operator, even though RNA polymerase sits at the promoter element, it fails to move downstream. So if we contrast it with the lac scenario, in presence of lactose, what we see? The active repressor is converted to inactive repressor and transcription is favored. Here, the inactive repressor is converted to active repressor, which binds to the operator, and there is no transcription. So it's just the opposite scenario. In case of lactose, in absence of lactose, the operon is switched off because the repressor protein is active. And when you give lactose, the repressor protein, lactose binds with the repressor protein, inactivates it. In case of tryptophan, the repressor protein that is produced is inactive and cannot bind to the operator. Hence, the operon is switched on. The moment tryptophan comes into the system, then the tryptophan binds with the repressor protein, making it inactive, and thus the operon is switched off. If you look into the basic difference, what are you seeing? You are seeing that in presence of tryptophan, the operon is switched off. In absence of tryptophan, the operon is being synthesized in case of repressible. So you see what is the two basic difference between the molecules that is causing the induction. Lactose is a food. It is a metabolite. It is not much that much necessary within the cell, and it is also not the preferred metabolite. Glucose is the preferred metabolite, okay? But when we think of tryptophan, tryptophan is an essential amino acid. It is one of the very important constitution of proteins. So a cell cannot take a risk of waiting for outside supply of tryptophan. A cell has an inbuilt system of producing tryptophan, and that is why when tryptophan is absent, the cell can produce tryptophan. It's inbuilt nature. Now the question arises, when tryptophan is given, why should I work? I'm getting tryptophan from the outside. So let me save my energy. So based on this concept, the moment tryptophan is provided from outside, the cell stops synthesizing the enzymes required for making tryptophan to save its energy. So tryptophan being an amino acid, the normal setup of the operon is switched on. Lactose being an metabolite, it's a food. And it's not also the preferred food. The normal setup of the operon is switched off. So this is the first basic difference between a negative inducible operon and a negative repressible operon. Now, this is a picture that we studied when we did transcription as well as translation. Now, this picture is becoming important in this context because right now we studied a very basic difference of inducible operon and repressible operon. And we saw that there is one mechanism by which the repressible operon can be controlled. In absence of tryptophan, an inactive repressor is produced, which can which cannot bind to the operator, so genes are switched on. In presence of tryptophan, the tryptophan binds to the inactive repressor to produce the active repressor, and the genes are switched off. But there's a second control to this tryptophan mechanism that is known as attenuation. And to study attenuation, you need to keep this in mind, is that in prokaryotes, this system prevails. What system prevails? That is, transcription and translation are coupled. I have lost my cursor. Okay. Transcription and translation is coupled. So the moment transcription has proceeded to a considerable length and the mRNA starts hanging, you see the ribosome starts trapping, attaching with the mRNA and starts translation also. So for prokaryotes, we have to remember when we will be studying the attenuation model is that in prokaryotes, transcription and translation are coupled, and hence the attenuation model of tryptophan is operative. So it's just a reminder of what is it. So I just now talked about the inducible repressible CYP system. I'm not getting into now tryptophan. So let's look into the tryptophan operon. If you look into the tryptophan operon, it's very similar to the lac operon. However, the regulator gene is not so shown here. The regulator gene would be sitting upstream somewhere here. So it's very similar to the lac one. It will have a promoter element. It will have its own P. It will have an coding region. And then it will have a terminator element. Downstream, we are having the TRP operon. So this is a picture of the TRP operon. And let us look at the components of the TRP operon. We have a promoter element. We have an operator element. This is important because operator is a region where the repressor protein, when activated by tryptophan, will come and bind. Now, this is the region from where our coding segment starts. So these are the tryptophan genes. E, D, C, B, A. So these genes, what do? They produce enzymes which ultimately convert chromistate to tryptophan. Okay. Now the difference between the lac and the TRP operon lies in this small region known as the leader region. You can see TRPL. This thing was not present in lac operon, and this is something that is coming up now in TRP operon. So just summarizing the TRP operon, we have a promoter element, we have an operator element, and in between the operator element and the first coding segment, we have a small stretch of DNA, which is now acting as the tryptophan leaders region. This tryptophan leader region, you see, can be synthesized into the mRNA. Before entering into the mechanism of how this is done, I'd like to point out one more thing here. Keep this in mind. When there is TRP present in the system, that means if there is TRP, tryptophan amino acid present in the system, that means tRNA, tryptophan, tRNA carrying TRP will also be present. So we have tryptophan and tryptophan tRNA in the system. In the cytoplasm, both of these are there. Then only this much of the mRNA will be produced, okay? But if we have a situation where the cell is starved of tryptophan, there is no tryptophan, and there is no tryptophan tRNA. So tRNA to tryptophan is also not there. In such a condition, so cell is starved of tryptophan, we will get this whole mRNA. We'll see how this is done, but we'll be getting two categories of mRNA depending on the condition of the presence or absence of tryptophan. To repeat, if tryptophan amino acid and tryptophan tRNA is there, then only we will get the small leader sequence mRNA, that is around 140 base pairs. And if there is no tryptophan amino acid and no tryptophan tRNA, then we will get the full length of the tryptophan mRNA. So how is this modulation done? How is the polymerase informed that synthesize only the tryptophan leader mRNA or synthesize the full mRNA? So the polymerase needs to be informed about the fact that either you synthesize, because you remember, is the polymerase who will be sitting in the promoter region. I think I lost my cursor. Wait just a second. Let me check also. The polymerase will be sitting in the promoter region. So somebody has to inform the polymerase at the promoter that there is tryptophan and tryptophan tRNA. So do not synthesize the full mRNA. Or there is no tryptophan and no tryptophan tRNA. you need to synthesize the full mRNA. So this molecular mechanism is known as the molecular model of attenuation and how it does it. So I'll be going over the class for animation, but before going to animation, I want to show you the magnified view of the tryptophan leader region. Now let's focus on the tryptophan leader region. So in my next slide, I will be showing you a magnified view of the tryptophan, showing a magnified view of the tryptophan leader region. So let's concentrate on this particular region. So this is something I discussed before moving on to the leader. I just showed you that how a repressible operon works. So when tryptophan is low, this is the inactive repressor that is produced. This is known as the aporepressor. It cannot go and bind to the operator. And so the enzymes needed for tryptophan biosynthesis are produced. So we are having transcription. But when tryptophan is high, the tryptophan binds with the inactive repressor, as you can see. And the active repressor now, once tryptophan has bind with the repressor, it becomes active. The active repressor can bind with the operator. And now we are seeing no transcription. So this is one control of tryptophan. This is one way tryptophan can be controlled. The production of tryptophan can be controlled. And the other way that tryptophan can be controlled is via the leader sequence, which I just now said that I'll show you now the magnified view of the trip operon leader DNA sequence. So this is this particular structure that we are seeing is, this is the 5' end. This is the 3' end. We have operator element present here. It has not been shown. So this is not the DNA. This is the mRNA that has been shown. So the question of operator doesn't arise. So this is the mRNA. So this is the 5' end of the mRNA. This is the 3' end of the mRNA. And from here, the first coding region or the open reading frame of the tryptophan gene starts. So that is E. This is E. This is the ORF for the first tryptophan gene to be synthesized. Prior to that, we have this leader mRNA. So just remember, there was this leader DNA sequence from which we got this leader mRNA. Now, if you look into this leader mRNA, as you can see by the structure, there are four regions of the leader peptide that can fold and form secondary structures by complementary base pairing. So let's look into these four regions. Region 1, region 2, region 3, and region 4. So one can pair with 2 because the sequences are complementary to each other. 2 can pair with 3 because the sequences are complementary with each other. And 3 can pair with 4. Remember, this is an mRNA and it's hanging. So in the cytoplasm, they can pair. Now, if one pairs with 2, a message is given. This message is pause. This message is given to RNA polymerase. If 2 pairs with 3, the message is anti-termination. That means the message is given to polymerase that you have to transcribe the whole mRNA. There is no tryptophan in the system. So do not open up. You have to transcribe the whole mRNA. And if 3 pairs with 4, this is the message given to the polymerase that tryptophan is in the system. Do not go for transcribing the whole mRNA. Open up. So you see, this 4 critical sequences present in the leader peptide actually form secondary structures and give information to the polymerase to either pause, to either open up, or to either continue transcription. Let me just pause the recording. This is how the tryptophan acid, the amino acid, is present. Then the operon is repressed and the biosynthetic enzymes are produced. One example of the repressible regulation in E. coli is the TRP-Operon. The two regulatory mechanisms involved in the control of the TRP-Operon is one we discussed just now, the production of an inactive repressor followed by conversion to an active repressor when tryptophan is present. But in this particular animation, this is a supplementary animation provided with the Russell's iGenetics. They are focusing on the mechanism of attenuation here. So, as I said, this is the TRP operon. So they have started it. So basically, we'll be focusing on the attenuation. Keep it in mind that the leader is present between the operator and the first coding region. And the leader, as I just now told you, has four sequences that can form secondary structures. So see, this is the tryptophan operon. It consists of the promoter, operator, the tryptophan leader region, and five structural genes, E, D, C, B, A. These five structural genes are transcribed as one polycystronic mRNA. And the five polypeptides translated from this mRNA is responsible for tryptophan biosynthesis. Now, in between the promoter, operator, and the first gene is the tryptophan leader region, which is now being magnified. So this is the mRNA of the TRP DNA, okay? Just now, as I said, it contains four important regions that can form secondary structures. So as you see, one and two signals pause, two and three signals anti-termination, three and four will signal terminations. So it's pairing of one and two pause, pairing of two and three anti-termination, pairing of three and four termination. Now, if you remember, there is no nuclear membrane in bacteria, and transcription and translation are coupled. Remember that. So the polymerase sits on the promoter and starts transcribing. See, it's transcribing. So it's transcribing the leader mRNA. So just here, this is the leader mRNA. It sat on the promoter and it started transcribing the tryptophan leader region. So we have the mRNA has come out. We have the AUG of the tryptophan leader, and the blue color region has also been transcribed. And now the polymerase is proceeding to transcribe the second region. See, the moment the polymerase has transcribed the second region, you saw that the ribosome was loaded on the mRNA. Now, the thing is that since ribosome has been loaded on the mRNA, and polymerase has proceeded earlier, a message needs to go to polymerase that you need to pause for the ribosome to load properly so that transcription and translation can go on, proceed in a coupled manner. So let's see. So you see, the moment the one and two segments have been transcribed, they will loop. As a result of this loop, this is the, if you remember, pairing of one and two is pause signal. This looping causes the RNA polymerase to pause so that the ribosome is allowed to catch up to it. After this event, the phenomena of transcription and translation are tightly coupled. So the ribosome is catching up. As you can see, now the regulation will be occurring by attenuation. So the ribosome is almost catched up. So one and two region will open up and the polymerase moves to that portion where region three has also been transcribed. Now, if we look into region one, this is important. in region 1, there are two codons for tryptophan. So if tryptophan and tryptophan tRNA will be present in the cell, then automatically tryptophan tRNA will be brought here. That is one situation. Or if there is no tryptophan and tryptophan tRNA present in the cell, the ribosome will have to sit here. So either of the two things happen. One is the ribosome, after reaching region 1, sits and waits for tryptophan bearing tRNA. If the cytoplasm has tryptophan bearing tRNA, then this tRNA will enter the A site, as we know for translation. But if the cytoplasm does not have any tryptophan bearing tRNA, then the ribosome will halt on region 1. Since the ribosome is, so if in a tryptophan starved condition, that is, there is no tryptophan in the system, what we are seeing, the ribosome is halting in region 1, which as a result, RNA polymerase has already proceeded and has synthesized region 2 and 3. Region 1 is blocked by ribosome because it is waiting for tryptophan to come, but there is no tryptophan in the cytoplasm. 2 and 3 will now pair. See, 2 and 3 has already been transcribed. So 2 and 3 will now pair. So let's see that. So the ribosome is waiting for tryptophan to come and there is no tryptophan. So ribosome has blocked region 1. 2 and 3 has been synthesized. So there is a coupling of region 2 and 3. This is an anti-termination signal, which indicates to polymerase that since there is no tryptophan in the system, you need to synthesize all the genes which are required for tryptophan biosynthesis. And we will be getting the full tryptophan mRNA, the leader plus the 5 genes. So we'll be getting the complete mRNA. So this is one scenario. Now let's go back to again the other scenario. Had there been tryptophan in the system, then what would have happened? So anti-termination, now if we go to that system where the ribosome has been loaded, the ribosome reaches region 1 and continues to wait and sees there is tryptophan tRNA. So what it does is synthesizes a small dipeptide of tryptophan and reaches the stop codon of tryptophan. Okay, so it synthesizes a small dipeptide here and it proceeds to proceeds downstream further to reach the stop codon of the tryptophan. And it is now occupying the part of region 2. The UGA is lying on region 2. So since the ribosome is occupying a part of region 2, and whereas polymerase has already synthesized region 3 and 4, so automatically 3 and 4 will now couple because since there is tryptophan, ribosome has moved from region 1 to the stop codon of region 2. This 3 and 4 pairing will tell polymerase that yes, tryptophan tRNA is available in the cytoplasm. You do not have to synthesize all the genes. So open up. So that is the termination signal. So it's the pairing of the 3 and 4 that acts as the actual attenuator, attenuation. What does the word attenuate mean? Cut short a thing. You're shortening, you're cutting a thing short. So it's the pairing of 3 and 4, which is giving the termination signal, which behaves as the actual attenuator in this system. So let's go over it now. So as tryptophan is blocking, region 2, region 3 and 4 has paired. And as you can see, the pairing of region 3, as a result of pairing of region 3 and 4, what did we see? Let's go back to that once more for ease. So pairing of region 3 and 4 results in termination. And as a result, we get a shortened leader mRNA. So cell deficient in TRP and TRP tRNA, we are getting only the leader mRNA. Sorry. Cell definitive tRNA, we are getting the full mRNA. When the cell is deficient of TRP and TRP tRNA, we are getting the full mRNA. If there is tryptophan and tryptophan tRNA in the cytoplasm, you see, we get only a small stretch of the mRNA. So this is the difference. So if there is tryptophan present in the system, and if there is tryptophan tRNA in the system, then we get only the production of the small leader mRNA. But if the cell is starved of tryptophan and tryptophan tRNA, that means the cell needs to synthesize its own tryptophan, then we get the full mRNA. So the presence of the leader mRNA or the presence of the full mRNA indicates that whether the TRP operon is totally, completely being synthesized. Specifically, if we look at the presence of the leader mRNA, this symbolizes that there is abundant TRP and TRP tRNA. If we get the full mRNA, this symbolizes that the cell is deficient in TRP and TRP tRNA. So looking at what kind of category of mRNA is present in the cytoplasm, we can see that whether there is tryptophan present in the cytoplasm or the cell is deficient of tryptophan. So leader mRNA, abundant TRP present, full mRNA, cell deficient in tryptophan.